طيب، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم. الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله، الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله، الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا نبي الله. العظمة لله تكبيرا، الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله والله أكبر، ولله الحمد. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما وعملا صالحا وفهما في الدين. يا فتاح يا عليم، يا فتاح يا عليم، يا فتاح يا عليم، افتح علينا فتحا قريبا، واجعلنا لك من عبادك الصالحين. يا فتاح يا عليم، افتح علينا وفقهنا في الدين يا رب العالمين. نوينا التعلم والتعليم والتذكر والتذكير والنفع والانتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة والحث على التمسك بكتاب الله وسنة رسوله والدعاء إلى الهدى والدلالة على الخير وابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى. آمين يا رب العالمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. To one and all viewing and watching, welcome to part four of the sort of Imamat course and leadership course. Again, for those who might be watching for the first time and had forgotten, we're going through the Nairu Rajah Bisharh Safinat al-Najah, the fiqh or jurisprudence of Madhab Imam al-Shafi'i. This is the fourth lesson, of course, the fourth and the final of the four-week course. And we get straight into it. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, tawakkalna 'ala Allah. As per usual, we go through our quick recapping of what we had gone through last week, and I felt that maybe last week I went through the last bit a little bit too quickly. Lakin Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. قال المصنف شروط الصلاح ثمانية. The preconditions or prerequisites before we can enter into the salah are the eight, which we touched on last week. Again, a reminder that a shart is something that is a prerequisite that happens before the salah. It's a prerequisite that needs to be made and met before entering the salah, entering any of the ibadat. That is what a shart basically means, a condition. Whereas when we come next up to the arkan of salah, you'll notice that a rukn or the arkan of an ibadah is something that is within the ibadah and a part of the ibadah itself. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. شروط الصلاة ثمانية. The preconditions, prerequisites to be entering into the salah are eight. الأول, the first are طهارة الحدثين, is purity from, as we've mentioned before again, is from الحدثين, purity from the two impurities, either الأكبر or الأصغر. That being the states of either being in a state of حدث أصغر or al-akbar, better known as being in a state of janaba. So purity from amongst from the two impurities. The second, wa taharatu ani najasati fi thawbi wal badani wal makani, and that is you are required to have purity from any najasa, any filth or any impurities in thawb, in body. Thawb, that being the clothing items, as well as the body and the place around which the person is making salah, if it's salah, it's the musalli or any other of the other ibadat. وَسَطْرُ الْعَوْرَةِ. Satru al-awra is obviously the covering of the awra, and that is all, again, that is all of the body for the female, except what is apparent being the face and the hands, and for the male, whatever's between the belly and the knees, is the awra for the man, that is. Number four was istiqbal al-qibla, is having been facing the qibla, finding the qibla and facing the qibla. After that was dukhul al-waqt, is that the time of the salah must have entered, Of course, we all know that you cannot be performing a certain salah if the time for that salah has not entered. وَالْعِلْمُ بِفَرْضِيَّتِهَا And is that the musalli or person musalli that's intending to make the salah needs to know that that salah is a fard and the fara'id of that salah in specific. وَأَلَّا يَعْتَقِدَ فَرْضًا مِنْ فُرُوضِهَا سُنَّةً Is that he or she, the musalli that would like to perform the salah, must not have a belief that that some of the acts or some of the portions of the salah that are fard, they must not have a firm belief that that is actually a sunnah act, for then they are entering the salah on the wrong basis and performing those acts with the wrong niyyah and on the wrong basis in its entirety. They must be very, very and completely familiar with what the fara'id of the salah are and not mistake it or its value or its categorization for being a sunnah and not a fard as it truly is. And last was the wajtinabul mubtilat. Wajtinabul mubtilat is what we will come to in a short while. That's part of today's lesson. And that is basically leaving off within the salah all of that which nullifies the salah and makes it void. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. We then last week touched over the arkan of salah, which are 17. It was 17 arkan. Again, the arkan are those items that happen within the boundaries of the salah. The boundaries there, the hudud, the boundaries being that once you have made your takbiratul ihram, Allahu Akbar. Once you've made your takbiratul ihram, you have entered in the boundaries of the salah. And when you're about to exit, the final border is the Taslim Salam. Salamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Those are the borders of the salah. Of course, as soon as you've entered into the salah, you are in a state of ihram, and that's why it's called the takbiratul ihram. So all of the arkan happen only between these two points, being a part of the salah, contrary to that which are the shurut of the salah. So we said the arkan of the salah, all that happens, or the integrals of the salah that happens in these times, are 17 in total. Al-awwal, an-niyyah. An-niyyah, as we know, needs to be happening first. It always comes in at number one. Al-thani, the second is takbiratul ihram. Takbiratul ihram, again, Allahu Akbar, entering into that state of complete ihram, in which things generally out of the salah that are permitted now become haram upon you. Example, eating in salah, obviously breaking the salah. The third is qiyamu ala al-qadiri fil fard. Al-qiyamu ala al-qadiri fil fard is that in this fard salah specifically and only specifically to the fard salah, that upon the person that is able to stand, it is fard upon him or her to stand for the salah. Al-rabi' qira'atu al-fatiha is the reading of the fatiha. The fifth is the ruku'. The sixth is tuma'anina fih. Tuma'anina fih is experiencing peace and tranquility in that ruku' that has been performed. Al-sabi' al-i'tidal, the standing up, coming up from ruku', when you say sami'allahu liman hamida and you come back up to a state of, come back standing up, that is called i'tidal. Experiencing the tranquility again is a rukn and is a must in the position of i'tidal. It's like that in ruku, it's in the i'tidal. After that, the next rukn is a sujood, two sujoods, the sajdatain or a sajda marratain. And obviously, as we've mentioned, the full and complete tranquility in the sajdatain and between the sajdatain as well. Between the sajdatain are the julusu sajdatain. Athani ashra, which is number 12 out of 17, is the peace and tranquility in that julus bayna sajdatain. The 13th one is at tashahud al-akhir, as mentioned again last week, is that the tashahud al-akhir, the second tashahud, alternatively either in the third or fourth rak'ah of your salah, that is the tashahud that is compulsory and is a rukn. It's the one that if missed out, the salah will be batil and invalid. Al-Qu'ud fihi is that you must be sitting for the tashahud. Number 15 out of 17 is Salatu ala al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that Salah ala al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a rukn also in this Qu'ud, in the sitting position, in the Qu'ud of tashahud, in the sitting tashahud. And after that is the salam. 16 out of 17 is the salam to complete your salah, and thus, as we've mentioned, to be exiting that state of ihram, exiting the salah. And number 17 out of 17 is at tartib, that all of these arkan must be executed in this order, in the order mentioned. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. I feel very important to quickly touch on the kinds of niyat before we move over to Salatul Jum'ah bi'iznillah. So Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qala al-Musannif, an-niyatu thalathu darajatin. He says an-niyya is of three levels. In kanati salatu fardan, wajaba qasdu al-fi'li wa ta'yinu wal fardiyyatu. Alright, so he's saying basically if it's a fard salah, you must clarify wajaba qasdu al-fi'li, why you are performing the salah, what type of salah it is, and it must be mentioned that it is a fard salah. That's the first. Second is a nafil salah, nafilatan, wa in kanat nafilatan muaqqatatan karatibatin aw dhat sababin wajaba qasdu al-fi'li. And if you are making a salah which is nafil, and if you're making a nafil salah, it's that you must specify why you are making the salah. Example, it's a salah of the duha prayer, or salah of the ishraq prayer, and so on and so forth. But you would not need to mention specifically that this is a nafil salah. Mentioning the ta'yin and the actual type of salah, example, the fard, is only applicable to the fard salah itself. The last one is a different kind of a nafil salah, or in kanat nafilatan mutlaqan. Mutlaqan meaning if it's just any kind of nafil salah, it's just a random nafil salah, just as you feel to perform, when, how, and as you please. It can just be sort of performed with just saying something as simple as Nawaitu raq'atayn for whatever it is. It's a very simple and straightforward thing. Most attention needs to be paid to the fard salah, in which that needs to be specified. And as mentioned in session number one, when we touched on niyyah specifically a lot, is I just like to recap these things. Remember that the niyyah is sufficient, it suffices that the niyyah is made in the qalb, lakin it's sunnah to be making nutq and lafz of it. It's sunnah to articulate it, while the fard of the niyyah, sufficiently it suffices that the niyyah is made in the heart, fil qalb. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. So before moving on from the niyyah, the specification is three. It was the fard salah, in which it must be mentioned that it is a fard salah, and the reason for the salah, and what salah it is. Example, whether it's a dhuhr, whether it's asr or maghrib, and so on and so forth. If it's another nafil, it can just be mentioned that it's a nafil, and the reason for the nafil. And the last was if it was a nafil mutlaqan, just a random nafil salah that's just being performed with no full purpose really. It doesn't need to be specified as much as the fard, nor as the first nafil. So what nullified the salah then, continuing with the salah, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, what nullified the salah then, were 14 instances in which the salah is nullified, in which you might be in the state of salah and experience something of the sort, and this then officially cuts off the salah, which means you would sort of need to, you would be exited from the salah automatically, and then you would need to either restart the salah or arrange to be in a better state to come back into the salah. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. I say so because obviously there are various circumstances and so on which we might find ourselves in. All sorts of things might happen. So let's get into it. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qala al-musannif tabtulu as-salatu bi arba'ati asharata khaslatan bil hadathi. That is bil hadath, if you end up in a state of breaking either your wudu or breaking your ghusl in the state while in the salah, bi wuqu'i an-najasati in lam tulqa halan min ghayri hamlin. All right, and that is if you experience najasa that might have missed on you and so on while you are in that salah, and it's almost difficult to sort of think how you might be sort of experiencing a najasa. Lakin if you're making a salah on the outside somewhere, or you're making salah in the field somewhere or something like that, some in some open space, for example, there tends to be a lot of birds and stuff like that, and they end up being some bird droppings on one of your shoulders or any of your thiyab and so on. Then obviously that puts you in a state of najasa, because that fresh najasa, remember, it's not dry or anything of the sort, and thus it will cut the salah off on condition that it's not, that you are not able to remove it. Should you be having something like a shawl, for example, you have a few moments to remove the shawl and toss it aside within the salah. That is fully and completely fine and acceptable, and your salah will be accepted on condition that it's only on the shawl and not missed on a thawb, that you would not need to move around too much to get rid of the najasa. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Wa inkishaf al-awrati in lam tustar halan. And that is the opening of the awrah. What also breaks the salah is the opening of the awrah. If it's not covered or recovered, basically with immediacy, within maybe a 1 to 2 seconds span, or 1 to 2 seconds of rope to really cover it up, it's a problem we often find ourselves and our brothers and sisters may be experiencing. More so a lot of the time, the brothers coming to the masajid and so on and so forth, and even at home, Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, is that it's either the t-shirt or something like that ends up being a bit short and so on when going specifically into the positions of ruku' and sujood and so on. So there's a 1 to 2 seconds grace that permits the musalli to cover that up, should that be experienced. Of course, prevention is better than cure in the bigger picture, really. But of course, there is a second or two, really maximum, of a grace period for the person to cover it all over again very, very quickly. However, should this not be done, then of course the salah is a batil and a void. Aura, very, very important. I find this is one of the problem areas that we don't always seem to get right, and it just so happens that our clothes end up being shorter than they're supposed to be. Wallahu a'lam. Next up was one nutqi biharfaini aw harfin mufhimin umdan, is a nutq or a mention of something, again mention only of something out of the salah and that is maybe not directed at Allahu Jalla Jalaluhu in the salah. Example, saying Yarhamukallah, that would obviously nullify the salah, because you're now speaking to someone else, where instead you could say Irhamhu Ya Rabb or Irhamhu, whereas it means the same thing, but instead of Yarhamukallah, where you're speaking to someone else that nullifies the salah, you speak directly to Allah and you're permitted to say Irhamhu, and that would be accepted. Wallahu A'lam. Of course, nutq and the articulation of things that are not supposed to be articulated within the salah, it does not have anything to do with the salah on its own, and thus that would nullify the salah. وَبِالْأَكْلِ الْكَثِيرِ نَاسِيًا, and that is with eating a lot out of forgetfulness. It's ajib, and it's quite interesting to see that the fuqaha had actually they're so stringent with regards to everything, and they never said something with akli qalilin nasiyan lakin kathir nasiyan, in which they say a lot of eating, obviously an eating of maybe like a full morsel or morsel or two of maybe food or a snack or something like that, out of forgetfulness, forgetting actually in the salah that you are actually in the salah and you are performing a salah and having eaten maybe a morsel or two in total, and obviously that then breaks the salah and requires that you start over. Of course, that doesn't nullify anything else, it just nullifies the salah as it is, contrary to the situation or circumstance or even scenario rather. Whereas if you found yourself having experienced a bird dropping on one of your on a part of your clothing that you cannot really move, is that you would obviously need to exit the salah and change clothing or wash the clothing out and so on and get yourself into full tahara, like we've mentioned in the section before this, fi thawb, of clothing, of badan, of the body, and of the makan, of the place in which you are making the salah. All of that needs to be back in order, and then you can come back and start the salah all over again. However, with something like eating, of course, that's not the situation. All that needs to happen is you basically need to make your niyyah all over again and restart the salah, and nothing else needs to really happen. Wallahu a'lam. وَثَلَاثِ حَرَكَاتٍ مُتَوَالِيَاتٍ وَلَوْ سَهْوًا. So what happens here is, and three movements of the bigger limbs, that is, obviously movements of the fingers and so on are really small items, but it's three movements of the bigger limbs. Three consecutive movements of the bigger limbs nullify the salah. Very important for people to realize this is that, example, the moving of the arm is one movement. The going up as well as the returning is considered one movement. It's not one, two, but it's one. So the movement of, example, a big limb, for example, like the arms, is one. The pushing out as well as the return of that limb is regarded as one, and not as two, being the pushing out and the return of that limb. Wallahu a'lam. And remember, this is three consecutive movements. So what happens is, if you scratch your ear here and then you scratch that ear there, and then you bring this one back up to scratch your nose, all one after the other without a break, that then has nullified the salah. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Movement of big limbs, movement of the legs, and movement of the bigger parts of the bodies, and so on and so forth. Three movements. Three consecutive movements definitely nullify the salah. He's also mentioned وَنِيَّةِ قَطْءِ الصَّلَاةِ وَنِيَّةِ قَطْءِ الصَّلَاةِ, is that when having made the niyyah of breaking the salah. Example, if a person has entered the salah and has continued with the salah, example, maybe recited the Fatiha and so on, and while busy with that, has now just remembered that maybe they had forgotten the stove on, or had forgotten the keys, the keys in the car, or something like that of the sort. Like, at this point of realization, and this often happens to people, is at this point of realization, if it was something that had sort of been of a little bit of urgency, the musalli might be pushed to have made a niyyah to break the salah in order to go and complete and fulfill what they might have thought about or wanted to do and so on. So if there was an inner niyyah, again, remember that the niyyah does not always need to be articulated, rather the niyyah is the mahal of the niyyah, the place truly of the niyyah is the qalb. And if the place of the niyyah is the qalb, and that in the salah, you just a niyyah is just made to have broken the salah in order to go and attend to something and so on and so forth. Every person knows themselves. If that niyyah to break the salah at that point in time and that instance is made, the salah is officially batil and broken off. Wallahu a'lam. So very important to have presence in the salah and so on, and to be cut off from everything, and not only that, but to have complete control of the heart, heart, mind, body and soul at all times. For it just seems that it might be a bit easy to be sort of prompted naturally by your natural human self, we'd say, to be able to do something like this, and before you know it, you would have broken your salah, which requires a restarting in its entirety. وتعليق قطعها بشيء. تعليق قطعها بشيء means the connection to breaking it off with something. Breaking it off is referring to the niyyah. So what happens with regards to the niyyah is that, to sum it up, it's a conditional thing, really and truly speaking, is that if someone is about to make their salah, and at number one is always the niyyah, and they make their niyyah, example to say that they will make their salah on condition that so and so does happen, or on condition that so and so does not happen. Mathalan is that if we have a young boy at a madrasa, for example, and he's or a boy, or even a grown man or a grown woman at a madrasa or something, for example, and they're making the salah, they're going to make the salah of the dhuhr or asr or maghrib, and when making the salah, they were waiting for a parent to come and collect them, and the adhan goes, and the time for salah is making qad qamat salah, that the time of salah is to begin, and this person had decided that they'd make the niyyah to perform the salah and complete the salah, of course, on condition that the parent has not come to collect, or on condition that the phone hasn't rung for the person to say, I'm downstairs, or I'm outside, or it's a missed call to say I'm outside, or it's a missed call to say I'm here to collect you, or a missed call to say I'm here to deliver something, and so on and so forth. So what happens is the niyyah is now hinged on a circumstance out of the salah. Hinged on a circumstance and something that has nothing to do with the salah, and thus that salah then from the very get-go is batil and null and void. So of course the niyyah needs to be it needs to be a sole purpose niyyah, and it should not be hinged on anything else, and nor should it be dependent on anything else, and it needs to be unconditional. There can't be any conditions on the niyyah and for how and when and why it will be performed. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. So that was that for the salah. I just wanted to sort of move over, seeing that it's the last, and even though we would have liked to do this much much earlier, is shift over to the salah of the Jum'ah. And of course the salah of the Jum'ah is something that we would have wanted to sort of, Allahu A'lam, but it would have been excellent if we touched on it a long time ago, for of course a lot of us are trying to make the Jum'ah in our homes and so on and so forth, making a bit of a shift over to Madhab Imam Abu Hanifa and so on and so forth, for we all know that in the Madhab Shafi'iyya is that you require 40 males to be attending the Jum'ah, and they need to be 40 residents of the place and so on and so forth. That clearly isn't happening under the certain circumstances that we find ourselves. Allah help us and make it easy for us, and thus those who are doing so and are performing as such in their homes and so on are generally making a shift over to Madhab Imam Abu Hanifa, in which the minimum requirement is 3, and according to others 4 in the Madhab. I think it's Imam Abu Yusuf, who says it was three, either one of the two students of Imam Abu Hanifa. I stand to be corrected, but I think it is Imam Abu Yusuf who had mentioned that you require three, including the Imam, and Imam Muhammad wa Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah wa rahimahumullah mentioned that it just needs to be four, including the Imam, or three without the Imam. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. So, the shurut again, prerequisites, preconditions, conditions in order to enter into and continue with the salah, salatul jum'ah, are six. Shurutul jum'ati sittatun, six. The conditions of jum'ah are six. Number one out of six, an takunu kullaha fi waqti dhuhri, is that the entire procedure, and continuance of the Jum'ah from start to finish needs to be happening within the boundaries of the waqt of Dhuhr and not out of that time. Number two out of six, وَأَن تُقَامَ فِي خِطَّةِ الْبَلَدِ, it needs to be in a sort of a city or a place, a town and so on, which has people. It can't be done sort of in a, maybe a rural or farming area or something of the sort. وَأَن تُصَلَّى جَمَاعَةً, obviously meaning that it needs to be recited as a jama'ah all together. It's basically that it's a festivity of the coming together of the people of that place and of that area. Thus, it's Yomul Jumu'ah, in which the people come on and make a jama'ah. Number four out of six was وَأَن يَكُونُ أَرْبَعِينَ أَحْرَارًا, أَرْبَعِينَ أَحْرَارًا, again, as I've mentioned just a minute ago, is that the one of the conditions in Madhab Imam Abu Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah is that it needs to be 40 men of the place and of the area, 40 men who are free, 40 free men, in order for the Jum'ah to be valid. And again, that's why we need to sort of make a khuruj out of the Madhab of Imam Shafi'i, because if any of these conditions are not met, of course, it does not classify it as a Jum'ah according to this madhab in specific. That is, and I remember we've obviously been back and forth with a lot of discussion and so on with regards to what the situation is, especially now with the lockdown here in South Africa at the moment, and what is to be done and so on and so forth. More specifically, so in areas where the Shafi'i madhab is very prominent. And one of the staunch Shafi'i scholars from Yemen had also mentioned that the all of the shurut are not being met, and thus it would be just better to perform the dhuhr and continue in that way. Lakin Allahu a'lam, and of course it's up to the people on whether they would like to take that opinion or make a khuruj into the madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us that which is best for us, that which pleases Him most, and to teach us and grant us understanding. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. So that shart, or that condition, was that they are 40 men who are free men and are people of the area. The last of them was that there needs to be a khutbatan, khutbah, and khutbatan, khutbah, one khutbah, two khutbatan. Obviously, there's the first khutbah, the imam sits down for a few moments, and he gives the second khutbah. Alright, then we move over to the arkanul khutbatain. Arkan, again, khilafan lil-shurut, is that the arkan happen within the khutbatain. So what is it within the two khutbas that keep the two khutbas valid are five, as mentioned below. قال المصنف أركان الخطبتين خمسة حمد الله فيهما والصلاة على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيهما والوصية بالتقوى فيهما وقراءة آية من القرآن في إحداهما والدعاء للمؤمنين والمؤمنات في الأخيرة. And that's five in total. So first up of the integrals of the khutbas are five. First is Alhamdulillah. Fihima, you notice a lot of the time is that both of them start with the hamd. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Alhamdulillahi alladhi yusabbihu lahu ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard, etc. Alhamdulillahi alladhi, and so on and so forth. Both of them will start this way, generally speaking. And this is the hamd that is required fihima to validate them completely. Wa salatu ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallama fihima, in both of them as well. Both of them, the first and the second, will contain undoubtedly the Salah ala Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wal wasiyatu bit taqwa fihima. Al wasiyatu bit taqwa fihima. You'll notice the Imam might say something like, Ayyuha al Muslimun, ittaqullaha fa inna Allaha ma'al muttaqin. It's wasiyah, it's to be inferring taqwa, inferring taqwa. Taqwa is people often in English somewhat translate it as fear, which I don't like personally, but I prefer something like presence or consciousness, alertness and awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, something of the sort, referring to what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had told us, had called Ihsan. Ihsan was, as he mentioned in Hadith Jibril, أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. And that is basically to know that you are in presence with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to be aware that you are in the sight and in the knowledge and in the hearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all times, all the time, every step you take, every move you make. This is taqwa ultimately. This is being present with Allah is taqwa ultimately, not necessarily just fearing Allah, but rather being present with Allah. And here, al-wasiyyatu bi taqwa fihima is that the Imam and the Khatib on the Yawm al-Jum'ah is to make wasiyah and to infer and pass over to you the reminder to have taqwa of Allah, a reminder to be present with Allah. And thus he will say things like usikum and so on, usikum bi taqwa Allah, or ittaqullaha fa inna Allaha ma'al muttaqin, and so on and so forth. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. So it's basically a reminder and an inferring, ayyuhal mu'minun, have presence with Allah, be mindful of Allah, be heartful of Allah. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Then of one of them is وَقِرَاءَةُ آيَةٍ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ فِي إِحْدَاهُمَا. So all of them needed to happen in both of the khutbas, in both of the khutbatain. وَقِرَاءَةُ آيَةٍ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ فِي إِحْدَاهُمَا. So a recitation of one of the ayat needs to be recited in one of the khutbas. Of course, if there's more, there's absolutely no problem with that, but obviously these are the integrals and the bare minimums that needs to happen. Most of the time it's inna Allah, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna 'alan nabi, ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu 'alayhi wa sallimu taslima, allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala sayyidina muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. A lot of the time, and most often obviously as well, is that an ayah pertaining to the topic that was spoken about is also recited within the first of the two, generally speaking, but obviously there are variations to what happens and to the type of what the khatib chooses, the style in which he will deliver. Thereafter, and the last of them is الدُّعاء للمؤمنين والمؤمنات في الأخيرة, is الدُّعاء for the مؤمنين and the مؤمنات in total in the last of the two. So it's not done in the first. Specifically, it's done specifically in the last, and again, it's done mainly in the last towards the end of the second one. So it's very, very important to note here, especially for those of us who are taking the Shuroot and the Arkan of the Jum'ah and so on and so forth, and want to take the Jum'ah into our homes with our family or whoever is around and so on. it's very, very important to know that one of the arkan is to make dua for the mu'mineen and the mu'minat in its entirety, for the ummah in its entirety, males and females. And why I mention so is because we might fall into making dua for ourselves and so on, saying Allahumma rabbi ighfir li warhamni wa tub alay and so on and so forth, not realizing that Allahumma rabbi ighfir li warhamni wa tub alay refers to one and only one person, when it was is supposed to be something like Allahumma ighfir li Allahumma ighfir li li wa li walidayya wa li jami'i al-mu'minina wal-mu'minat, or you know, something of the sort that includes all of the mu'mineen and all of the mu'minat in the entirety, and this obviously continues to keep things valid and in order. Very, very important, if that mistake is made, all of the arkan have not been met, and thus the khutbatain would not have been valid. And without the khutbatain not being valid and not and incomplete, we would not have fulfilled the shurut of the Yom al-Jum'ah, which then nullifies the Jum'ah in its entirety. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Quickly, I just whizzed through, our time is sort of up, and quickly I just whizzed through the last thing, which is the conditions of the khutbatain is ashara, and that is purification from the two impurities, the big and the small, purification from any impurity on the thawb, any impurity on the body of the khatib, of course, and of the place, in the masjid or the musalla or the area in your homes that you might be using. Satrul awra, the covering of the awra of everyone. Qiyamu ala al-qadir is the standing of the person who can. The sitting between the two khutbas, that's very, very important. The sitting of the two khutbas, that's one of the conditions. And the continuation, it's not that there can be a long break or something else can be done and fulfilled and then you come back and perform the second khutbah or anything like that. There needs to be consecutiveness and continuation of these things. It also needs to be in Arabic. The two khutbahs need to be in Arabic. The 40 people that we mentioned need to be attending the Jum'ah, needs to be able to hear it, so it must be heard by the 40 people. Of course, if we're making an exception, whoever is in the and so on in the room or so on, if a Jum'ah is being performed in the home or in a private space, it must be heard by all people present, inshallah, or minimum of 40. Of course, that's not really happening right now. Wallahu a'lam. And the last but not least, وَأَن تَكُونُ كُلُّهَا فِي وَقْتِ الظُّهْرِ, as that was in the shurut of Jum'ah, is that it must all be done within the waqt of Salatul Dhuhr, and not out of the waqt of Salatul Dhuhr. So that brings us obviously to the end of the fourth session. I tried to go sort of as quickly as possible to cover almost everything, and basically we have covered everything. I hope that this was beneficial, and I hope that we had taken some notes and so on. I really, really, really hope that it's given us some drive and some himmah to actually take on that role in our homes and in our private spaces for our families and so on and so forth, and that the course in its entirety had sort of given us a little bit of an edge to take at least one little step further and practice on some of these items and lead our families and so on and so forth. For ultimately, as is always said, charity starts at home. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said, the best of you are those who are best to their families, and I am the best to my families. I am the best to my family, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who are best to our families, and that especially to the family of the beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi. والحمد لله رب العالمين فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.